you all for joining us this evening. My name is Jill Dolan. I'm a professor in the program of theater in the Department of English here at Princeton, and I also direct the program in gender and sexuality studies. I'm delighted to welcome all of you and our distinguished speakers to what I'm sure will be a really engaging event. I want to begin, as usual, with a few thank yous. This program is made possible by several different units at Princeton. Events like these are always about collaboration, and it's always very nice when mutual interests come together to bring guests like those assembled today to campus. So first I want to thank the Lewis Center for the Arts, particularly the chair, Michael Cadden, and Tim Bassam, the director of the program in theater, for their support. The Lewis Center handled all of the administrative details, including the beautiful poster design, thanks to Tracy Patterson, and the communications from an office headed by Steve Brunk, and ably staffed by Hope Van Cleef, Jacqueline Sweet, and Justin Goldberg. Rick Pilaro and Steve Wright always provide excellent tech support, and I want to thank Matthew, whose video is taping today. I also especially want to thank the incomparable Joseph Fonseca, who couldn't be with us today, but who did so much of the organizing labor for this event, and Amy Nash, who stepped in to fill his shoes and has done a remarkable job today. Thank you so much. I also want to thank the Office for Muslim Life, in particular the chaplain, Sohag Sultan, right here, and the Department of English, in particular the chair, Bill Gleason, and the Program in Gender and Sexuality Studies, in particular our program assistant, Sandy Volker. Events like these really aren't possible without multiple avenues of support and labor, and I really appreciate all of them. Finally, I also want to thank Fawzia Afzal-Khan, who came to me with the idea for this event and helped organize it from start to finish. And I want to thank all of our guests for taking the time out of their busy schedules to be with us today. So just a word about how we'll proceed. We're going to start with two readings, one by Ayad Akhtar and the other by Aasif Mandvi, followed by critical and historical commentary from our two scholars, and that's Fawzia and Neilesh, Bose. And then Jamil, Khoury will discuss his work as a playwright and producer. Then after that, I'll pose some questions. We'll have a bit of back and forth among the panelists. And then we'll open the panel discussion for your questions and comments. And we plan to end by about 8 o'clock. What I'll do is I'll briefly introduce the speakers right before they speak. And I just wanted to point out that extended bios are in your program, and you can also look on the Lewis Center website for more information. So, to our first speaker, and they're not sitting in the order of appearance, which is why I'll introduce them before they speak. Our first speaker is Ayad Akhtar, a Pulitzer Prize-winning playwright, screenwriter, and novelist. I've had the great pleasure of seeing his 2013 Pulitzer-winning play, Disgraced, on Broadway in a stunning production that closed just last night. The play unflinchingly atomizes how identity is both deeply ingrained and socially imposed and navigated. His play, The Invisible Hand, was recently produced at New York Theater Workshop in another beautifully wrought production. The play turns a bold eye on questions of capitalism, terrorism, and difference. He's also the author of the poignant coming-of-age novel, American Dervish, and the domestic drama, The Who and the What. Please join me in welcoming Ayad Akhtar.
Center in 2012, to great acclaim, was nominated for Lord's Hell, and was brilliant in the role. I thought there's a wonderful monologue. Well, I know it's wonderful. I wrote it, so there's a monologue in the first act of the play that Aasif, I thought it would be kind of fun if Aasif read.
Yeah.
Yep.
I should introduce you, too.
Well, you'll get a second. He's
still okay. Second.
I like how we did that, like we didn't plan it.
Oh, really?
You want me to read?
Oh, wow.
Okay.
Can you give them just a little introduction for people?
Why don't you do it? Give them a little introduction, and I'll just be the actor and have a week.
Oh, they are.
So this is the beginning of the play, and Amir is, it's a Saturday morning, his wife, who's white and very interested in Islam and Islamic themes,
has been sketching him in the morning, and his nephew comes by. He's been pestering Amir about going to help with this case. There's an imam who's been wrongfully accused, and Amir has some background in the public defender's office. He's now in corporate law, corporate mergers and acquisitions. And so he has this animus toward Islam and toward just this imam and all of this stuff. And so at some point he starts talking about this, he gives this one. Early in the play.
And it's precipitated by his nephew saying that it's just a phase that you're going through. Mom says it's just a phase.
The phase being that you don't like Islam and all that, it's just a phase.
It's just a phase that you're going. Sit down, Hussein. I want to tell you something. No, I want you to sit down first. When was the first time you had a crush? I'm getting to it. Your first crush? Fifth grade? I was in sixth. Her name was Rivka. Susan was the first girl I ever kissed. Rivka was the first girl I ever got up in the morning thinking about. One time, she went away to Disney World in the middle of the school year. I was abject. Didn't even want to go to school if I couldn't see her. She was a looker. Dark hair, dark eyes, dimples, perfect white skin. Just wait. So Rivka and I had gotten to the point where we were trading notes. And one day, my mother found one of the notes. Of course, it was signed Rivka. Rivka, my mom says. It's a Jewish name. Now, I wasn't clear on what exactly a Jew was at the time, other than they'd stolen land from the Palestinians and something about God hated them more than all other people, but I couldn't imagine God hating this little girl. So I told my mom, no, she's not Jewish, but she knew. The name was Jewish. If I ever hear that name in this house again, Amir, she said, I'll break your bones. You'll end up with a Jew over my dead body. And then she spat in my face. That is so you don't ever forget, she says. Next day, Rivka comes up to me in the hall with a note. Hi, Amir, she says, eyes sparkling. I look at her and I say, you've got the name of a Jew. She smiles. Yes, that's because I'm Jewish, she says. Then I spit in her face. Right. So when my older sister goes on to you about this way and the other way, now you'll have a better idea of the phase I'm really going through. It's called intelligence.
So that just gives you a little sense of, of disgrace. That's just a little taste of disgrace. I thought I'd read a little section from the Episcopal Hand play that I just had up at the New York Theater Workshop. And this can be up at a couple of different regional theaters this year, maybe in London. The Episcopal Hand is about why an American investment banker with trading background in commodities who gets kidnapped by a local extremist militia. When he's kidnapped, his company as standard for Citibank, say, well, it's actually Citibank, the tax, can't negotiate ransom because it's against U.S. anti-terrorism law. So the number two in this extremist group is a very shut off, very clever young fellow who was born and brought up in Hounslow, London, but who's now moved to Pakistan to join the good fight, quote unquote. And he realizes that they have a traitor. They can use the traitor, put the traitor to work to raise his own ransom off of their capital. So that's the beginning, that's the setup for the story. And the group is led by a fellow by the name of Imam Saleem, who is a godfather type of figure in this extremist group. So I'm going to read you a little monologue where this imam first appears on stage, and he is talking about. He's sort of explaining to Nick, this commodities trader, why it is they do what they do and what they're doing. When I started out in the world as a young man, it was as a journalist, writing for the
newspaper in Bahawalpur, south of Lahore. You know it. That was my home, where I was raised, where my family is from. I knew the place, I knew the people, I wrote local news. Stories I hoped would make a difference. An entire year's wheat crop lost in a fire. A new technique for digging wells that made it easier for farmers to irrigate their fields. I wrote a lot about farmers. A child born to a sharecropper's family who had a remarkable ability in maths. Truly remarkable. That article was a success. Someone with the power to do something read it. That young boy got a scholarship to go to London. The one thing I couldn't write, the one thing that really mattered was corruption. There is a road from eastern Bahawalpur to some of the outlying villages, a road that some 50, 100,000 people depend on. Unusable, pockmarked with potholes the size of a city bus. Nangmi Road. Every year in local council, Nangmi Road was at the top of the list. Every year it was brought up in parliament, every year it was voted on, approved, paid for. For 10 years. But the road has never been fixed. I wrote the article, told the story of where that money might have been going. My editor killed it. Of course I was fired, lectured about how I should know better. 2 days later, my father was coming home from work. Three men ambushed him. They were riding motorcycles. They beat him to the ground with chains. My father was left on the side of the road. They said, tell your son not to worry about Nangmi Road. It's fine, just the way it is. For 3 days he survived. Long enough to berate me for my foolishness. You see, we are prisoners of a corrupt country that is our own making. But don't pretend you don't participate. You do, of course you do. That's your job. That was Mr. Kerry Martin's job at Citibank, to grease the wheels, to rape and plunder our nation. I commend you for not saying anything, Mr. Wright. One of the many things I never seem to have learned, that the key to success in life is keeping one's true thoughts to oneself. It was a very long path from that young man whose father was killed because of him, to the person you see before you today. A long journey, but a straight one. A clean line. A clean line of outrage. So that's that. So shifting focus, and I know the subject of today's, you know, discussion is Muslim identity on the US stage. It's a very important subject, and one that I'm actively writing about and continue to be writing about. I'm working on a new play, and the new play is about debt financing. And it's about the moment in American culture when debt ceased to be, when debt became an asset. And it sort of tracks a Michael Milken-type figure who is a financier of the age, who's vilified because of new financial techniques that he's using, vilified for being Jewish. The play's story is basically Merkin character raising enough money to take over the first Dow Industrial Jones company, a company in the Dow Industrial Jones, which is a steel company. And they're basically gonna break it up and sell it, as the corporate raiders did in the 80s. So, this little speech that I'm going to read to you is Merkin addressing the private investor conference for his investment bank in the wake of a lot of the bad press that they are getting about this deal. Past few weeks, the news, the papers have been filled with nasty words about a pending deal. All of us in this room are watching pretty closely. Deal financed by money many of you put up. It's Saratoga McDaniel's ongoing bid for Everson, Steele, and United. Reading, seeing some of these pieces on the news, I don't know, you think we were like locusts come upon the land. I mean, all the images of small town American life in Reading, Pennsylvania, the steel mill nestled restfully against the tree-covered hills, the workers coming through the gates with their hard hats and lunch boxes, fathers fathers who were told we'll be out of jobs if Ray Peterman has his way. They're making this into a story about newfangled financial wizardry and its terrors. We're told that Sackerlohl and yours truly in particular are enabling the destruction of the values that made our nation great. The locusts now, the frogs can't be far behind. Of course, I don't agree with any of that. Though there certainly is something wrong in America right now. And it has nothing to do with the purchase and sale of corporate debt. No, the media's fear-mongering about this deal and all its waxing poetic about the death of American manufacturing, frankly, it feels to me sometimes like I've stepped into some kind of collective delusion. The bizarre, self-serving belief, feeling that we Americans are somehow better than others. That American-made is better, whether it's American steel or American cars or televisions or washing machines or whatever. No evidence is offered. Just nostalgic rhetoric about what our fathers and their fathers and their fathers sacrificed and how great they were and how we, here in this room, are endangering that legacy. And marrying all this Norman Rockwell sentimentality to the nasty xenophobic trades about the slink-eyed Asians copying our stuff and the dirty spics taking our jobs, and you have a picture of what is actually wrong with our country today. There is a blindness out there right now. And it is not the blindness of those who see nothing but dollar signs. No, it's a different kind of blindness, far more pernicious. It's the blindness of a nation unwilling to question itself, unwilling to learn from the evidence of the marketplace. Because see, the marketplace is telling us that our steel isn't as desirable as steel made in China. It isn't as cheap, as quickly produced, or structurally superior in any way to the product purveyed by Everson, or Bethlehem, or U.S. Steel. The same is true of our cars and appliances, our electronics. The Japanese, Koreans are making all these not only cheap, more cheaply, but better. Honda is a better car. That's just the truth. That's why I drive one. But what do we here in this country? We're Americans. We invented the automobile. We built the greatest steel mills the world has ever known. God bless America. I mean, let's set aside the revolting assumption that God doesn't bless other nations, or that somehow an American father's job is more important to his family than a Chinese father's one is to his. And let's just set aside all those lies and delusions, and let's just stick with the facts. Fact, they are winning. Fact, we need to understand why. Fact, we need to change. I mean, it's easy to hear the market's message when it's singing you a song about how great you are. Much harder to heed the hard wisdom in harder times. When you stay blind, you can't change. When you can't change, you die. And that is what is happening in this country right now.
Thank you so much. That gives us a lot. Probably could have called the panel the Dramaturgy of Economic Climate. Now it's my pleasure to introduce Aasif Mandvi, who is an actor and comedian, perhaps best known for his work as a regular correspondent on The Daily Show, and for his Obie Award-winning one-man performance at Kina's Restaurant, as well as his starring turn in the Merchant Ivory film, The Mystic Masseur. He recently published, I have a prop, his terrific book, No Man's Land, in which he details his life as an Indian-American actor and comic, navigating his way through the British private school system, Christian study groups in America, and the often racist territory of Hollywood, as well as his relationships with his Indian, British, American immigrant parents. Please join me in welcoming Aasif Mandvi.
No Lands Man.
What did I say?
You said No Man's Land, which is, no, I did that on purpose. So that people would have to say it twice. I'm going to read you an excerpt from my book, which is also a speech given by Michael Milken. Which is about my experience of coming to New York and being an actor in the
New York City in the early 90s when I first got to New York. This story is called Patanki. Upon arriving in New York in the summer of 1991, I spent most mornings standing outside the Actors Equity Building on 46th Street at 5 a.m., holding my headshot, my resume, a cup of coffee, and a bagel, along with hundreds of other actors. We were all waiting to audition for an associate to the associate to the associate casting director for a role in, well, frankly, anything. Pippin, Death of a Salesman, Romeo and Juliet, it didn't matter. I even once stood in line for 4 hours to be seen for a role in A Raisin in the Sun. It's not that I hadn't read the play. Okay, fine, I hadn't. But I had seen the movie. However, the one thing that kept me going as a young out-of-work actor was the belief that someday someone on the other side of the table would be so impressed by my monologue and or 16 bars of a song that they might even be inspired to cast one really eager South Asian actor in a play about an African-American family in the 1950s. I guess it was also fair to say that there were not too many roles for South Asian actors. So, although hoping to be cast as Black, Latino, Native American, or Arab was a long shot, it was often the only thing available. Hey, I once played a Sephardic Jew for a murder mystery company, and don't think I didn't put that in the special skills section of my resume, because I did. When I first arrived in New York, like everyone else, I was big on dreams and short on experience. For the previous 2 years, I've been working at theme parks in Orlando, improvising and doing comedy bits with the guests who came through the gates at Disney MGM or Universal Studios. Other than that, when I first stepped off the train at Grand Central Station, my professional career consisted of a production of Danny and the Deep Blue Sea down in the back room of a nightclub, a production of Aladdin and His Wonderful Lamp performed across the Sunshine State for grades K-3, an extra in an independent karate movie shot on location in Winter Haven, Florida, and one line in the TV show Miami Vice as the doorman outside the Biltmore Hotel. I acted the shit out of that line. A couple weeks after arriving in the city, I saw it as a sign that I had made the right decision when movie star and theater legend John Malkovich exited the building and almost bumped into me on West 46th Street. As Malkovich turned and walked towards 6th Avenue, I stared at the doorway that he had just come out of. A sign above the door read the American Place Theater. It was an unassuming building, and the theater seemed to exist below street level. But it was clearly a place where movie stars hung out when they were not plastered on billboards and subway ads. This is where they go back to their roots, I thought, where they leave behind the high-stakes business of the Hollywood box office for a period of time and reconnect to the simple magic of an actor standing on a stage in front of an audience telling a story. I decided that this was what I wanted. This was the door I wanted to pass through. From that moment on, being John Malkovich became a symbolic mantra for me until Spike Jonze stole my thunder a few years later. The first item on my road to conquering New York was to get an agent. After 8 months or so, I succeeded. I say that like it was an easy thing to do. It wasn't. I don't want to bore you with the details of how to write a cover letter that is attached to a headshot that could possibly make you stand out in a sea of a million other headshots and resumes, most of which end up in the trash. That any actor competes against on a weekly basis in order to even get a single meeting. My first audition was for a national television commercial. I was very excited since this could be a big payday, not to mention I was a terrible waiter. I was quickly discovering that even though I was living in a railroad apartment in Queens with a group of South American grad students, New York was still really expensive, and it took a lot of time and effort to make just enough money to cover rent and food. A national commercial would solve a lot of my media problems. It was for the role of a snake charmer in a commercial for an insurance company, or possibly a bank. Either way, a snake charmer was an odd choice, I thought, but why they needed one was not my concern, as long as they were going to pay me. I walked into the audition room, and after stating my name, I was asked to read some lines off a cue card while pretending to charm a snake out of a basket. I picked up the fake flute and pretended to play while I said the lines for the camera. After I was done, the director conferred with his cohorts and then asked me something that seemed obvious to them, but took me by surprise. Could you do it again? This time with an Indian accent. Now, truth be told, I had never been able to do an Indian accent before. I had never been asked to do an Indian accent before. Even though I had been born in India, I left as an infant and grew up in the UK and then in the US, where the coalescence of my West Yorkshire and Floridian accents made me sound like I was from Brooklyn. I wasn't even sure if I could do an Indian accent. The only Indian accent I had any reference to was my parents, and the last thing any immigrant kid wants to sound like is his father. However, I was an actor, and this was a paying gig, so I picked up the flute and gave it a go. I was terrible. I couldn't do it. I prided myself on being able to do most any accent, British, Irish, French, Italian, Hispanic, but for some reason, I could not do an authentic Indian accent. I knew how it was supposed to sound. I had heard it all my life. But my mouth and voice refused to create the sound in my head. Like a tone-deaf singer, I was Indian accent deaf. I couldn't find the lilt, the upward inflection, the clipped consonants. I even wobbled my head from side to side, the way Indians have been doing for thousands of years, hoping it would shake loose the accent buried inside of me. No such luck. The words coming out of my face sounded like either an effeminate Russian or a very polite Arab. Definitely not an Indian. To my surprise, however, the producers seemed unfazed. Well done, that was great. One more question, he continued after a moment. Do you own a turban? Excuse me, I asked. Our wardrobe girls don't know how to tie a turban, so if you happen to own your own turban... I don't, I said. I don't own a turban. Well, because I don't wear a turban. Of course, he said, starting to sound slightly uncomfortable. If I owned a turban, I would probably have worn it, I continued. It's not something you leave home without. I don't know why I was combative. Perhaps because I still couldn't believe they could not tell that I had just done the shittiest Indian accent. Did they not care? Didn't they know what an Indian accent was supposed to sound like? It seems like a pretty essential bit of information if you're casting a commercial featuring an Indian snake charmer. Of course, said the director, that makes sense. We just thought, do you know how to tie one? Because, no, I don't, I said, flatly. That's when it got weird. Sorry to ask you this, one of the assistants piped up sheepishly, but we're asking everyone. Do you know how to actually snake charm? I don't, I said. But I am Indian, so it's probably in my DNA. There was a pause. Of course, the director said, sorry. They are all silly questions, but the client insists. So let's do it again, and this time don't worry about being too big, because we want this to be funny. In most other auditions, this would have been an innocuous comment, and of course, just lazy direction. But I was beginning to realize he wasn't talking about being funny. He was talking about something else, something that was making me uncomfortable. I loved performing, because it always had been a place where I felt freedom, acceptance, and expansion. In theater school, in plays, in theme parks, whenever I performed, it had only ever brought me joy. But now, in this moment, for the first time, I felt something I'd never felt before, shame. I knew that I was about to do something that my parents would be embarrassed to see. My stomach tightened as I imagined my friends attempting to be supportive and smile as they watched me on television doing this potentially offensive caricature. I thought for a moment. I could walk out. I could stand up and say, this makes me uncomfortable. I didn't come to New York to be Apu. I came to being John Malkovich, which would sound a bit Tourette-y. I admit, but nevertheless would affirm my mantra and make a great exit line. I stared at their faces, these nice, smiling Caucasian people who had no idea what they were asking me to do. Then I remembered the rent was due at the end of the month. Would I once again ask my landlady for a little more time? Every month I gave her the same sob story. I remembered how much I hated waiting tables. I remember that paralegal job where reading a 300-page legal brief about faulty valves had actually made me consider suicide. I remembered that there were 10 other actors sitting outside the door that would do this part, no questions asked, and laugh all the way to the bank. If I didn't do this on principle, one of them would. And then what difference would it make? What statement would I be making? Maybe if I did do it, I could have control over it. I could give this bobble-headed, snake-charming cartoon character some nuance, complexity, humanity. I mean, for God's sake, what was my problem? It was a fucking stupid commercial. I should just do it, take the money, and this time next year, no one would even remember it. But I would know, I thought to myself. I would hate every minute of shooting it, and I would spend the next few hours before it aired feeling anxious, and a few months before it aired feeling anxious and humiliated. I stood up from my lotus position to confront them. And also because it's an incredibly uncomfortable way to sit. So you want it to be broader, I said to the director. You want it to be more like a cartoon. Well, we want it to be funny, they said as they looked at each other. The accent, the head wobble, it all makes it funnier. We want it to be funny. I looked at them in the eye, took a deep breath, and said, okay, I think I know what you want. I sat down and assumed the lotus position. I wobbled my head from side to side. I channeled the broadest Indian accent I could think of by pretending to be Peter Sellers at a party. I channeled Apu from The Simpsons. I even channeled Fisher Stevens in brownface from that 80s robot movie. I was actually trying to appear on national television doing the same accent that if someone had done in front of me, I would have punched them in the mouth. The whole thing worked like a snake charm. For the more I did it, the more the producers smiled, and soon they were laughing uncontrollably, especially when I smiled and stared at them as if I didn't understand what they were saying. I attempted to soothe my humiliation by focusing on how much money I would make by hitting what was clearly the brown cash cow jackpot. Dude, that was so funny, said the director when I finished. Thank you so much for being a good sport. I know it's probably a little politically incorrect, but it's comedy, right? Of course, I said, I totally get it. Anything for a laugh. I did not get the job. I assumed that they had cast some other brown actor better studied in the art of snake charming, and to be honest, part of me was relieved. However, when I saw the commercial a few months later, I saw to my horror that they had cast the swarthy looking white guy. There he was, bobbing his head from side to side, smiling and talking with a broad, terrible Indian accent, without a care in the world as to what his parents would think of him as he charmed the shit out of that rubber snake. Though I was never asked to play a snake charmer again, I soon noticed a peculiar pattern in the roles I auditioned for: cab drivers, deli owners, doctors, and terrorists. As time went on, I became more and more numb to what was being asked of me. My friend Sakina Jaffrey, a South Asian actress, even coined a name for it, Patanki. The word is derived from parodying the sound of an Indian accent to the ear of a white person. Patank, patank, patank. Say it to yourself. Did you do it? Yes? This part of the book is interactive. Now try saying it with an Indian accent. Give it a shot. It doesn't have to be perfect. Did you do it? Now wobble your head from side to side. This will be difficult if you're not South Asian, since it's a motion that is confusing to Westerners, but is instinctively understood by anyone who has even one drop of subcontinental blood in their veins. Don't worry if you don't do it perfectly. You never will. Okay. Now that you're saying patank, 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 and wobbling your head from side to side like a dashboard bobblehead, you're experiencing what my first few years as an actor in New York felt like. If you're laughing right now, you're a racist. Patanking was not just a dialect. It happened when an Indian character in a movie or a TV show or a commercial was void of any human element and became simply a disembodied accent, head wobble, or turban. It was also sometimes the only way to make a living. And I was completely culpable, for I gladly pretanked my way as far up the ladder as I could. Eventually, I didn't even think about it. I gladly served up a one-dimensional cartoon of my culture and family for the entertainment of middle America. I turned a blind eye to things that I could not justify, such as why a character born and raised in the West would even have an Indian accent. Why a character that was clearly Indian would be named Epstein. Why a Muslim character would have a Hindu name. Why an Indian would be speaking Arabic. Why a character originally written as black or Hispanic or Jewish could just as easily be played by an Indian without needing to change a single piece of vernacular. Why a tan white actor could play South Asian, but a light-skinned South Asian could not play white. Why an Iranian accent sounded identical to an Indian one. Why South Asian actors could be funny or nerdy, but never sexy, yet South Asian actresses had to be. I got so used to twisting myself into a metaphoric pretzel in order to fit into the way that Hollywood portrayed South Asian or Middle Eastern characters that I didn't even realize I was doing it. But then something began to change. After playing countless South Asian stereotypes, I began to feel a need to create something real. If I was professionally not able to play anything more than a peripheral and undeveloped character, except for some reason in Shakespeare and in school, because apparently non-traditional casting is okay if the audience doesn't know what the actors are talking about or it's for educational purposes, then I would tell those stories myself. I started writing characters from my ethnic and immigrant experience in hopes of creating a one-man show. The characters were unlike that of any I had ever had the chance to play. They were as complicated and conflicted as the people they were inspired by. For the first time, the audience would not think, look, non-traditional casting, good for them, that's very progressive, when they saw me walk on stage, as they had in every play I had ever done. This time, they wouldn't even notice. They would just see a South Asian actor portraying three-dimensional South Asian characters. There'd be no suspension of disbelief, except for the usual kind. With this in mind, I began to write what would become my one-man show, Sakina's Restaurant. The first character I developed, Sakina, was a combination of me and my sister. I quickly realized that though the play would enable me to return to my roots, it would require me to do some non-traditional casting of another variety. I would have to play all ages and genders. So one of the first things I did was put on a pair of heels and a miniskirt and walk around my apartment to see how it felt to talk and walk like a teenage Indian girl. Yeah, all right, great. That's all we have time for. I've been told to end. There's
so much. No lands, man. Next we have Fawzia Afzal-Khan, who is a University Distinguished Scholar, Professor of English, and Director of Women and Gender Studies at Montclair State University. She's the author of 5 books, including her recent controversial memoir, Lahore with Love, Growing Up with Girlfriends, Pakistani Style. I had the pleasure of moderating a panel that included a solo performance Fawzia presented at the Fertile Crescent Conference on Gender, Art, and Society the last time she was here in Princeton. Please join me in welcoming Fawzia.
Well, now for the less fun part of the evening. But thank you, Jill, for agreeing to host an idea that my co-conspirator there, Neilesh Bose, and I had actually at the launch of Aasif's book, No Land's Man, which was to bring him and Ayad together on stage here to honor their contributions, as well as to critically evaluate their work in the broader historical context of South Asian Muslim representation on US stages. And it seemed like a particularly propitious time to do that. So I'm going to actually just try to signpost 3 broad points that I think we might hopefully take up later in our conversation tonight. The first could be grouped under the ideas of sexuality and empire. The second, Islamophobia and Islamism. The third, the profit motive and the politics of piety, or said another way, market fundamentalism versus Islamic fundamentalism. And then tying all of these together is the idea of the politics of representation. So to begin, having just heard a piece of Aasif's wonderful memoir, I just want to turn to something else in it, which is his desire as a young man growing up, an adolescent, his desire for women, as well as his fear of women's sexuality, whether that woman is, we'll get to the fun part. Whether that woman, I don't know what it's like now, Aasif, we can talk about that later. Whether that woman is a white Christian girl that he's trying to impress with his knowledge of Christianity in Florida, or a Muslim hijabi woman that he meets
on a train
to Bradford. Okay, you'll get your chance. So I think that what this adolescent culturally conflicted sexuality, why it's interesting is that I think it's because it's linked to, or it maps on very interestingly to what we might call the politics of empire. Because in this context, the Muslim male's coming of age sexually and otherwise proceeds alongside, usually alongside established Orientalist tropes of desiring, on the one hand, the white woman as a trophy, and on the other, perhaps more recently, the hijabi Muslim woman that a liberal and liberated Muslim man might feel he could, that he could help. What I think is, you know, his self-deprecating humor and the self-reflexive gaze that he uses in writing and in his, you know, in all of his work, that is what recasts these tropes into a family drama whose inclusion in the story of his life in this book humanizes quite poignantly their both the family as well as himself in a way that displaces what could have been an orientalizing female objectification onto this other register, which I'm calling the politics of empire. Aasif, it seems to me, dramatizes this immigrant narrative of a Muslim Indian family through the use of a self and other mocking narrative which produces laughter more often than it does tears. And one never really feels a fear of real ongoing violence in this, you know, that might be committed either by them or at them, even though a discursive violence remains palpable and does indeed affect Aasif's own quest to become an actor on stages where roles for brown South Asians are confined to stereotypes like playing snake charmers in search of authentic accents. Yet he retains his humor and self-love through various indignities until the moment where he can launch a counter-offensive to these reigning stereotypes by writing and then successfully performing his one-man play, Sakina's Restaurant, in the late 1990s, where the play, meant for a 2-week run, ends up running sold out for 6 months. And what I'd like to say is that I think this act, opened the gates to the rise and recognition of other people like actor turned novelist and now playwright Ayad Akhtar, pushing Ayad to further explore and push further these boundaries, and that's partly what I'm going to also mention in a few minutes. I want to turn to Islamophobia and Islamism, my second point, because by the time that Ayad is writing and achieving acclaim, first Muslim American of Pakistani background to receive a Pulitzer in 2013, the stakes have changed quite drastically in this charged political climate of the post 9/11 era. What needs to be dramatized now is a political violence of a rather different and more vicious order than that described by Aasif growing up in a racist Britain in the 70s and later after his family moved to the US. Aasif had needed, I think, in his cultural and historical moment to show how his mother, rose above cultural stereotypes of Desi moms who only want their sons and daughters to become engineers or doctors and marry endogamously. Indeed, she is his, probably his greatest supporter in wanting to explore this career on the stage. But in Akhtar's prize-winning play Disgrace, the stakes, having changed, seem to demand a dramaturgy of political violence, which leads Akhtar to recreate a stereotypical Muslim mother whose anti-Semitism becomes a motor, actually, propelling her son in the play to shun his Muslim Pakistani roots in his rush to become American and to rise up the corporate American ladder. Amir Kapoor, who becomes this anti-Muslim protagonist because he perceives a mounting hysteria in the US against Islam and Muslims, which he wants to avoid. And in doing so, he is also resisting the calls of Islamism or political Islam as represented in the play by the nephew and an imam on trial for putative ties to Islamic extremists. I would like to propose, therefore, that we ask how both these playwrights and actors dramatize the struggles and challenges of Muslims on US stages who seem caught between the Scylla of Islamism on the one hand and the Sharbaitis of Islamophobia on the other. Aasif seems to me to be fighting the Sharbaitis of Islamophobia using the weapons of satire, which he wields to expose the racist ignoramusness of Islamophobes. He has become, especially post his role on The Daily Show, a jihadist of irony, wearing the burdens of representation rather slyly. Akhtar's work, on the other hand, seems more focused on examining and exposing the self-delusions as well as the self-hatred of Muslims linked to Islamist ideologies on the rise in both traumatized post-colonial Muslim nations as well as within marginalized Muslim immigrant communities in Western countries. The downside of this dramatic choice is obvious, which is, as I mentioned before, possibly recreating images of Islam and Muslims that can feed into an always already and increasing Islamophobia. However, I'd like to argue that Akhtar's envelope-pushing work can be seen also to hint at the need to move past the politics of and to discard the burdens of representation into what I might call a post-respectability moment. This moment is instantiated by two directions in his work that his work has taken post-disgrace. The first of these places us squarely in the realm of sex and gender politics in his play, briefly alluded to by Jill, The Who and the What. Because the most progressive and daring figure, I contend, in his oeuvre to date, who actually signals this beyond moment, beyond the politics of respectability moment, is the Muslim female scholar of Islam, Zarina, who is the protagonist of this play and who insists on seeing the Prophet Muhammad not as a paragon of virtue, but as a real man undergoing, possibly, a crisis of masculinity, which prompts him, Muhammad, to take wife after wife after wife to prove his own sexual prowess, thus forcing audiences to question, at least me, perhaps, is this the price of humanizing Islam? That its prophet and its Muslims have to be seen through a prism that some might see as blasphemy? And is this blasphemy also linked to examining, not just examining, I would say, but also challenging the very regressive sexual politics that seem to be at the heart of militant Islam's current revivalism. And finally, the second direction taken in Ayad's latest play, also alluded to, The Invisible Hand, we heard him do a reading from it, begs another and equally important question, which is, what is meant by, what might be the function of this, the invisible hand that guides the actions of individuals in the so-called advanced economies of the West, who actually represent much more than just their individual selves, even where they may not think so. The play becomes an exploration of the links between the individual profits of commerce on the one hand and national identity and gain on the other, as spelled out also in a book of the same title by Adam Smith, written in the late 1700s. What Ayad is dramatizing then in this play is not, I would say, the clash of civilizations a la Samuel Huntington, but rather the synergy, the coming together of the profit motive with the politics of piety, coming together of Western market fundamentalism with that of Islamic fundamentalism. The Citibank trader, and let's not miss this, Princeton-educated Nick Bright, becomes in this place, universe, a mirror image of his Islamist captors, forcing us all as viewers to ask, aren't these Islamists, far from being anti-modern, simply bearded versions of the brightest profiteers working within secular modernity's prison house? Is Ayad Akhtar's unfolding and constantly evolving dramaturgy of political violence nudging us as audiences, perhaps, to consider how each side, each individual and collectivity is coevally implicated in these raging conflicts of our times? I'd like to conclude by quoting a wonderful comment that Aasif makes to the actor Omar Sharif in his memoir when he encounters him while he is an actor on the main in New York City. He says to Sharif, acknowledging everybody knows Omar Sharif, right? Dr. Zhivago, yeah. He says to Sharif, acknowledging the profound effect that seeing him play the hero, a brown man at that, in Dr. Zhivago, had on him as a 9-year-old boy with dreams of becoming an actor himself when everyone else in the movies except Sharif was white. He says to Sharif, Dr. Zhivago changed my life. To which the bemused but witty reply comes, really? It changed mine too. Aasif, I would simply like to say that seeing you on stage doing those many roles, multiple roles at Sakina's restaurant all those years ago, changed the lives of many of us Desis who had dreams of seeing ourselves, whether it be as actors or writers or academics on US stages. And Ayad, seeing you reach these heights of acclaim and recognition here in the West and in the US especially, I think is opening those vistas further for ever more challenging, complicated representations and histories to be seen and performed both on stage and hopefully embraced in our lives. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Fawzia. Our next speaker is Neilesh Bose, who teaches in the history department at St. John's University. He's an historian of South Asia and researches 19th and 20th century nationalism, religion, and culture. He's the author of two books, Beyond Bollywood and Broadway, Plays from the South Asian Diaspora, and Recasting the Region, Language, Culture, and Islam in Colonial Bengal. Please join me in welcoming Neilesh Bose.
Thank you. So I will start with a vignette about a play that ran on New York stages for several months, as it did on the other side of the Atlantic Ocean. It featured a Muslim character who hates himself, one who embodies violent, irrational, and disturbing character traits that provoked fear, loathing, and curiosity in many. In fact, it inspired all sorts of polemic, debate, accusation. And audiences in New York were aghast yet stimulated by this depiction of this Muslim character. And many of you may presume that I am referring to Ayad's disgraced, the 2013 Pulitzer-winning prize play, which is a Fanonian tragic investigation into the contemporary psychopathology of the post-colonial world. I am not. I'm actually referring to Dion Bosico's Jesse Brown, or The Relief at Lucknow, written during the Indian Mutiny Rebellions in 1857-58, staged in New York and in Denver, on tour in North America, as well as various cities in England in 1858. And today I'll share a very brief history of South Asian Americans, as well as the representations of South Asians within the US theater from this 1858 starting point to the present, with an emphasis on the contours and limits of recognition, particularly regarding Muslims in US theater spaces. Now, before I get into that history, contemporary tropes about Islam and Muslims in the United States have frequently conflated Muslim with Arab. Whereas the vast majority of Muslims, past and present, exist in South and Southeast Asia, and their experiences have been embodied by syncretistic identities, minoritization, particularly in India, and a multi-religious, multilingual cultural landscape. In the United States, South Asian actors have frequently been cast as Arabs, and rarely the other way around, yielding an asymmetry in the representational reservoir of Muslims in the US imagination. And for much of the United States' history, it has been quite hard to find representations of specifically South Asian Muslims and their particular identities and cultures outside of a security state imagination, instantiated first by Boucicault's play back in 1858, which I'll speak about in just a minute. Now, the appearance of Aasif's play, Sakina's Restaurant, with Eye of Disgrace, the Who and the What, and the Invisible Hand, the US space does now, of course, feature characterizations of South Asian Muslims on US stages, authored by and enacted by Muslims themselves. And of course, many artists and organizations, including but not limited to the work of Silk Road Rising in Chicago, led partially by Jamil, have been doing this for several years, before and after 9/11. The point, rather, is to just follow Fawzia's comment that the success and recognition of Ayub and Aasif, I think, here in the Metropolitan Center of the US Theater in New York, it opens up an exploration of that history for the sake of considering and building a different future. So this brings me back to Dion Boucicault's Jesse Brown for the Relief at Lucknow, a melodrama which depicts the lives of Europeans in India during the 1857-58 rebellion, a moment of global crisis for the British Empire. In this play, a group of Europeans just outside of Lucknow, during the so-called Siege of Lucknow, summer of 1857, including the young single girl Jessie Brown, a Scottish girl, is fearing the worst as a group of Indians, all Muslims, approach this group of Europeans, and they include one Nana Sahib, who was a real historical person, but in real life he was a Hindu Brahmin, and he was a big part of the rebellion. But in the play, he is a fantastical composite Muslim. He happens upon one Mrs. Campbell, a widow of an officer. He expresses his love for her and his interest in her for his harem. And rejection of him sets the stage for a melodramatic move for the Europeans to organize and then defeat the rebel Indians. This is during the rebellion. And though Nana Sahib is defined by Islam, he is also politicized against empire as he asks, quote, "Did Allah send the Briton here to make us slaves, to clutch us beneath his lion's paw, to devour the land? Inshallah, the voiceless word of Allah has swept over the people, and it says, sufferers, arise, ye shall be free." The final act shows Europeans awaiting sure execution, captive in a mosque, and Europeans are experiencing delirium, including the young Jesse, who has visions of Scottish Highlanders saving them, and lo and behold, at the end they do, and the Indians are then defeated, and this last part did happen in Lucknow in the summer of 1857. Now, Jesse Brown activates for the theater an emergent discourse that became hegemonic in imperial circles at this time in the Anglophone world, namely that Muslims were aggrieved during the 1857-58 rebellion because of their religion being violated, that's one, and that Muslims were the ones leading the way toward violent rebellion. Now, this is absolutely historically inaccurate, and I can discuss the historiography in the question period if there's interest, but from 1858 through the mid-20th century, South Asian Muslims occupied a security state imagination, activated by this first representation by Boucicault. What endures from this moment also is an elusive quest for white women that ends in failure, as well as a self-hatred, however politicized in the context of empire for Muslims. Now, in Eye of Disgrace, in 2012, first produced 2012, winner of the prize in 2013, and just finished a run on Broadway, the Muslim characters are, of course, not wearing glorious robes with hanging swords and colorful turbans, as they did in Jesse Brown. But they turn out to be 21st century bourgeois equivalents in the US security state imagination. Muslims whose religion and existential political disaffections only cover up the violence just simmering beneath the facade. In the years between Jesse Brown and disgrace, of course, much has changed in North America. During the era of Jesse Brown, a few thousand South Asians in North America lived on the margins of US and Canadian society, and then were excluded from citizenship, like all other Asians in this continent, from the 1880s to 1946. And after 1965, the historic Hart-Celler Act, which overturned the 1924 Immigration Act, which had barred Asian migration into the US, barred further Asian migration, South Asians have established communities and patterns of visibility in line with the broader changes within US society. Now, to North American theater history, very briefly, South Asian Muslims have proceeded along a history of particular absence in the 1858 to 1965 period for a variety of reasons, mainly because of the rise of Sanskrit and classical India dominating the performing arts in North America from the early 20th century to the mid-20th century. But from the post-65 period, we do have a history that requires attention. Just to give a few examples, we could look to Shishir Khoury, whose adaptation of Shakespeare's Merchant of Venice, titled Merchant on Venice, placed in Southern California of the post-9/11 present, includes an Indian Muslim, and a Bori Muslim at that, in the role of Shahrukh, the Shylock equivalent, whose Indianness and Muslim minoritization feature quite heavily in that play, or Rehana Mirza's Barriers, depicting intergenerational family drama in light of the post-9/11 present, Raisins Not Virgins, 2005 play by Bangladeshi-American Shabari Ahmed about Muslim-American women, and Wajahat Ali's 2006 Domestic Crusaders about a post-9/11 Pakistani-American family, staged in the United States and throughout Britain by Thara Arts by Hitender Verma. Now, all of these are preceded by Aasif Sakina's Restaurant, a one-man show about immigration to the United States, and significantly about an Indian Muslim family. Written and produced in the 1990s and the 2000s, and published in 2009 in the anthology that was mentioned, Beyond Bollywood and Broadway, available at bookstores throughout the world and online. From then, the emergence of plays like Disgrace, The Who and the What, and The Invisible Hand by Ayub fit into this trajectory from 19th century melodrama to naturalism, to realism, to our present-day predicament, which could be called a postmodern predicament, which solidifies a history of assimilation, which is paralleled by other groups, of course, Mexican-Americans, African-Americans, and other groups as well as assimilation into post-war U.S. theater aesthetics, including the emergence of the bourgeois, cultural capital, evidenced in the dinner parties, the family units, the critique of political economy, and so on. So I'll just close as quickly as I can on three points of departure, which enable questions, hopefully, about potential horizons of aesthetics outside only of assimilation. Now first, are depictions of Muslims in U.S. stages confirming or challenging canonical guidelines in U.S. theater? Does the emphasis on assimilation into spaces of power and recognition solidify canonical guidelines, or do they subvert those canons? Secondly, to follow up on Fawzia's comment, what role does white female sexuality have to play in the travails of representing Muslims? It seems like a requirement. The protagonists of Disgrace, for example, and many other narratives that we can speak of, Meladi What We Know by Jihad al-Rahman, The Reluctant Fundamentalist by Mohsen Hamid. A key part of the life course of a protagonist is a relationship with a white woman of status and means, and then the breakdown of that relationship. How central must white female sexuality's power be in determining the Muslim characters of today and of the future? Do we have to follow, in a way, black skin white masks, which is, of course, the precedent for these discussions? Finally, what is the role of South Asia within the conceptualization of a recognizable character as Muslim? In Disgrace, as one example, the protagonist is defined by his South Asian placement in the world. This is how he can change his identity. Yet the South Asian part of him is relatively under-examined. And this refers back to the asymmetry I mentioned about the underexplored South Asianness and the relatively clear Muslim politicization that does appear in the Muslim characters that we know of within our theater. And how does this imbalance play upon our imaginations for the future? Finally, the broader historical significance of this work for the US theater lies in the implications for writing and enacting cultural difference. Approximately 30 years ago, debates about issues like Peter Brook's staging of the Mahabharata concerned the Orientalist baggage of metropolitan theater practitioners like Brook, like Schechner, Barba, Bertowski, and many others. And the debates there were about metropolitan theater practitioners, and whether or not they were Orientalist. Whereas now, South Asian and Middle Eastern playwrights, actors, producers, critics, scholars, And diasporic spaces like this one are reshaping the conversation for the 21st century, posing the ability to enact characterizations of Muslims and to intervene onto a broader critique of the world system, something unthinkable in metropolitan theater spaces of the Mahabharata moment of the 1980s or in earlier moments of global crisis, 1858, 9/11, which have offered assimilationist responses. And just a last point to follow Fawzia, The Invisible Hand, Aya's last play, signifies, I think, an innovation in this trajectory, in the encounter between the Nick Brights of the world and the British Asian Bashirs, the Imam Salims in post-colonial Pakistan. How do they converge? They converge through a parallel of the idealized market fundamentalisms of the West, which are seen right alongside the idealized critiques of political economy, whether coming from Islamic reference points or from entangled post-colonial commitments. And such a move, I think, offers a chance to ask the important question, which I think is the question to ask, of how we as Muslims and non-Muslims alike may imagine a future distinctive from the deeply colonial past that continues to shape our present.
Thank you so much. Our last speaker is Jamil Khoury, who is a playwright and the founding artistic director of the theater collective Silk Road Rising in Chicago, which promotes playwrights of Silk Road backgrounds. In the summer of 2013, Jamil was instrumental in launching a dialogue with director Mary Zimmerman, who was then directing her adaptation of The Jungle Book based on the Disney musical and Kipling stories for the Goodman Theater. Zimmerman's adaptation created controversy over her choice of racial representations. On the Silk Road Rising website, which I encourage you all to look at, when he published a conversation he and a colleague subsequently had with Zimmerman, Jamil said something that I'd like to quote for a moment because I think it captures the spirit of our panel. He said, quote, "Honest conversations about race, representation, authenticity, and ownership are vital to a healthy, robust, representative American theater. We join with tens of thousands of fellow sojourners in working to create an American theater that looks and sounds like a 21st century America. An America in which the normative is the polycultural." I'm delighted to finally meet Jamil after admiring this and other statements he made about this issue and others. Please join me in welcoming Jamil.
Thank you so much, Jill. It's such an honor to be here. Okay, let me get situated for a moment, still getting the reading glasses thing down. But, allow me to back up about 13 years to 2002. My life partner, Willie Galani, and I, we founded a theater company, as Jill just told us, called Silk Road Rising. And it was created in response to the terrorist attacks of September 11th, 2001, and to the climate of anti-Muslim, anti-Arab, and anti-South Asian sentiment that seized our country in the aftermath of the attacks. We felt particularly compelled to respond theatrically to discourses articulating a clash of civilizations, pitting a monolithic West against a monolithic Islamic world in an apocalyptic battle of good versus evil. Basically, the West was at a crossroads, and Islam was in the crosshairs. The speed with which clash of civilizations entered America's political lexicon as a rationale for war and expanded state surveillance was both enormously shocking to us and deeply disturbing. Media and pop culture representation of Muslims, rarely good to begin with, fast aligned with the execution of a war on terror that all too often claimed Islam, civil liberties, American Muslims, and those perceived to be Muslim as its victims. So my partner Malik is a Pakistani-born Ismaili Shia Muslim who has lived in the US since the age of 7. Religiously, Malik identifies as Muslim. I am a US-born, mixed-blood Arab-American of Syrian Christian heritage. I identify religiously as culturally Eastern Orthodox. So in other words, Malik and I are an ISIS, Al-Qaeda worst case scenario. We're a Wahhabi nightmare. We're not supposed to exist, and yet we do. And our ethno-religious positionalities inform our commitment to the mission of Silk Road, as do our subjectivities and knowledge as gay men. Which brings me, conveniently, to the representation of gay men and lesbians in America's 20th century and how that representation corresponds to Muslim representation in America's 21st century. Historically, and perhaps a wee bit to this day, American gay men and lesbians were represented through three lenses: psychology, religion, and law. As objective, impartial categories, psychology, religion, and law seem fair enough. But as tools for defaming and injuring queer people, they are, in fact, quite lethal. Psychology told us that we were crazy, pathological, unstable, incapable of sustaining relationships, prone to self-destructive behavior. We were an addiction rooted in unresolved childhood trauma. If we were men, we had overbearing mothers and distant fathers. If we were lesbians, we had bad experiences with men. Religion told us that we were sinners. We were evil. We defied nature, threatened families, signified social decadence and moral decay. We were incompatible with righteous living, and we were plague carriers, stricken ill through divine retribution. Not even God liked us. The law told us that we were criminals, social deviants, predators, susceptible to blackmail, gender nonconforming. We were indecent and obscene, of dubious citizenship, and we posed a grave danger to children. Just ask Alfred Hitchcock about gay men and criminality. Psychology, religion, and law essentially branded gay men and lesbians, and American culture and public policy embraced the brand hook, line, and sinker. Even the American theater assimilated the central tenet of the time: tragic lives begin tragic ends. Murder, suicide, or AIDS. Take your pick. Building on these examples, I would argue that in today's America, Muslims are also largely represented through three lenses. And those three lenses are national security, patriarchy, and liberalism. Discourses on national security tell us implicitly and explicitly that Muslims threaten us. Muslims are violent. Muslims will kill us. They're prone to terrorism. They blow things up. Muslims pose an existential threat to our nation and to our way of life. Therefore, they are suspect, all of them. A liberal Muslim and a moderate Muslim are but extremists in waiting. Even the best Muslims are secretly bad. Patriarchy, we are told, has a very good friend in Islam. In fact, Muslims are to patriarchy what butter is to bread. It's male subject, female object, and that subject is possessive and controlling. There may be misogyny and sexism in all religions, but Islam is patriarchy on steroids. If men beat and rape women, then Muslim men beat and rape women even more. In a nutshell, Islam is bad news for women, Muslim women are oppressed, and Muslim feminists are rarely to be found. Then there's liberalism. Liberalism, with its emphases on liberty, equality, civil rights, electoral politics, freedom of religion, freedom of expression, and the persistent tension between individual desires and collective responsibilities. In American cultural production, Islam gets depicted as the antithesis of liberalism, liberalism's polar opposite, not only incompatible with liberal values, but at war with those values. And it's not simply ideological or even theological, it may in fact be biological. Muslims possess an innate, inborn aversion to all things liberal. They are by nature authoritarian, tyrannical, void of empathy, averse to self-criticism and introspection, volatile, and understanding only of force, pluralism, power sharing, tolerance for opposing viewpoints, and respect for the other are all signs of weakness in the quote-unquote Muslim mind. Obviously, you don't have to agree with my three-lens theory, and of course, there are exceptions. But for our purposes this evening, I think it fair to say that what I've identified are recurring themes that are deeply disturbing. Now, I am aware that the politics of challenging Muslim representation can quickly devolve into the politics of prescribing and policing Muslim representation, which is a death sentence for artists of all backgrounds. Counter-representation and alternative representation that responds to dominant representation can only go so far. So the challenge becomes to respond less and to own more, and to stop ceding power and legitimacy to narratives about Muslims that effectively harm Muslims and harm non-Muslims as they reinforce people's worst fears about Muslims. What's exciting to me is how we as theater artists address these lenses of national security, patriarchy, and liberalism. I'm not saying that we can't apply these lenses to Muslim characters or to plays that are somehow about Muslims. Judging from Silk Road Rising's production history, I'd be an absolute hypocrite to suggest that. And of course, we can't ignore the cultural zeitgeist with all its fears and phobias either. But we can and must support artists as they create space for new narratives about Muslims to emerge. Narratives that acknowledge, interrupt, and subvert my three lenses, and ultimately render them reductive and woefully dated. Thank you.
Thank you all so much. I think we've heard a wonderful, very, very rich series of comments, of presentations, of remarks, starting with Ayad and Asif's wonderful readings of their own work. I just want to throw out a few ideas and questions, and then we'll turn to questions from the audience. But if the panelists would like to respond to one another's work, here are a few things that I would synthesize from this really rich conversation. We have a genealogy that Neilesh was so generous in providing that demonstrates the ways in which these issues arise over hundreds of years. We also have several critical frames in which to look at this work through questions of patriarchy, of sexuality, of gender, as well as nationalism and religion. We have questions about the burden of representation and how an artist navigates that without, as Jamil just said, policing representation. How is it that artists and critics and spectators, for that matter, can own more stories and different stories to intervene in what are clearly stereotypes, especially in popular culture? The question of sexuality in terms of the relationship with whiteness, South Asian identity and whiteness here is an interesting one, not only for female protagonists, but I'm reminded in Ayad's play, The Who and the What, that the love interest of Zarina, the female character, is actually a white man who's converted to Muslim, which raises all sorts of interesting questions about authenticity and not. I'm also curious about questions of casting, who plays who, has come up a number of times here, what that means in terms of those politics. And finally, how theater brings both joy and shame, which I think Asif's reading spoke to so well, and Neilesh's question about how we imagine a future out of all of this through actually the theater. These are just a few of the many, many things in these wonderful remarks that struck me. Maybe I can start by asking Ayad and Asif about the question of the burden of representation, especially around questions of patriarchy, sexuality, that Fawzia and Neilesh and Jamil raised especially. And, okay, go ahead.
The burdens of representation.
Yeah.
You know, in my work, I use my own human experience as sort of the raw material for what I write about. So I can't say that I honestly focused that much on, it's interesting to hear you talk about the work in a way that is that I can't and wouldn't.
Right, that makes sense.
And so in terms of representation, I mean, in terms of my own writing, I don't know if I think I'm trying to go in and trying to tell a story from inside my experience, and that becomes my my draw or my quest to try and excavate my own experience in a way to present it. And often I don't know what the outcome is going to be. I don't know what the representation is going to be. I mean, I clearly am now looking at a lot of my writing. There are themes that I emerge, but there are not themes that I was conscious of in talking about that.
Well, I mean, I just want to put it, I mean, that's in the chapter that you read, which I also alluded to, which, you know, because obviously it's a chapter that sort of speaks to this issue, and that is, you know, where you explain, you talk about some of the roles, right, that you were offered and your struggle through that. So, I mean, I find that there's a lot of consciousness when you take that on, and you have this sort of a certain kind of snide, not snide, certainly ironic distance from that, but also you're struggling against it, and you sort of see it for what it is, which is to say these limited, stereotypical roles, and how does someone who looks and has the history that Aasif Mandvi does, how does he negotiate, right?
Right.
And you're very clear. I mean, you also talk about how you sort of, you struggled with, for example, that bit about the snake charmer, right? That you struggle with, well, am I going to take on this burden of representing Indian and authentic Indian in this way, or am I going to challenge it? And you were very honest about speaking to the dilemmas that it raised for you as a working actor who also needed to make money,
yeah,
right?
And that is an absolutely, I mean, that, recounting that, from that period, I mean, I don't have the same, I don't have to deal with those same issues anymore in my career in the same way that I did when I was younger. But that exactly was the conversation that I had within myself and others who were of South Asian or, you know, brown actors had about how do we handle, like, you know, you go and, you know, there were some actors I knew who would just say no, I won't represent my culture, my people, or anything in this way. And for a long time, those people didn't work, you know. And so what? And so that was a constant conversation about how, you know. I remember I was offered a film in 1995, a Disney film called Hidalgo. I was offered. I had an audition for it, and I was asked to go to this audition, and the movie was about a horse race in the Arabian Desert. And it was based on a true story of an American cowboy played by Viggo Mortensen, who went into the Middle East and rode his American horse in this Arab race across the desert, and won. But the irony of it was that they were making this movie right in 2002, right when the U.S. had just invaded Iraq, or was about to invade Iraq. And I remember there was a line in the movie that said, where Viggo Mortensen's girlfriend is talking to him before he goes to the Arabian Peninsula to run in this horse race, and she says, "Go get some Arab ass cowboy." And I remember reading that line and just saying, "I can't be in this movie. I can't be in a movie that says, 'Go get some Arab ass cowboy.'" didn't know why, because it was a big movie, and, you know, I think they finally took the line out of the film, I think.
It's a good example of another sort of theme I heard in many of your comments is the relationship between individual choices, like the one you're just suggesting, and this larger burden of representation as an artist, where you feel beholden to or responsible to a larger community in terms of representing. So it's interesting to me that your solo show represents multiple characters, and also it's a solo show too. It's interesting to think about how many solo shows kind of break those stereotypes in the history of representation. But I have how do you come at these questions of the burden of representation?
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah.
You know, it's interesting. I don't have a ton of time to read these days, so I have this book that's been in my bag now for a while. And I've been reading this book, and I'm still on like page 70. But there's this wonderful passage that I just read. I read it like 4 weeks ago, but I just read this book. And I want to read from it. You know, some of the, some of the tensions raised in some of the comments about what I'm up to, I think point to inherited, point less to inherited representations than to inherited ways of seeing. And I think that the burden is on the interpreters, actually. And I frankly find that some of the characterizations to be lacking in the kind of body and nuance that the work actually has. And so that's my challenge to the two of you, and you guys have done that. So here's my comment. Some of the frisson of trouble that my work has caused in general in the Muslim community has been compared to the trouble that Mr. Philip Roth experienced with his Jewish community in the late 50s and early 60s. As I've been saying over and over, I don't think anybody's commenting on whether I'm as good a writer as Philip Roth. I'm not. I have any thoughts about that. But I think that the comparison does. And so here Philip Roth says that he admits that the attacks on him and his work at the beginning of his career were absolutely decisive in his growth and success as a writer. As he tells it in The Facts, after a particularly ugly public ordeal during which he was attacked by nearly all sides at a symposium called, quote, "The Crisis of Conscience in the Minority Writer of Fiction," end quote, held at Yeshiva University, Roth swore over a pastrami sandwich at the stage delicatessen never to, quote, write about Jews again, end quote. "I couldn't see then," Roth writes, quote, "fresh from the event, that the most bruising exchange of my life constituted not the end of my imagination's involvement with the Jews, let alone an excommunication, but the real beginning of my thraldom. The yeshiva battle, instead of putting me off Jewish fictional subjects for good, demonstrated as nothing had before the full force of aggressive rage that made the issue of Jewish self-definitions inflammatory. How could I conclude otherwise when I was told that every word I wrote was a disgrace?" Interesting. So I think that at the end of the day, Jill, you know, I've had a fortune or misfortune. It's everything, whatever you live in life, you know, it's an interesting experience. It was a day of events at Appalachian State University around my work. And there were three scholars assembled, a philosophy professor, English professor, and then a conflict professor. And they all read American Dervish, and you know, they were commenting. They read American Dervish and disgraced it, and they were commenting. You know, philosophy professor said, you know, some interesting ideas, this, that, and the other. Take it or leave it. The English professor said, you know, some beautiful writing, put to me the mind of this work and that work. And the conflict professor got up, and incidentally, she'd come up before the talk, and she'd said, "By the way, I want you to know I actually really like your work."
That's fascinating.
Okay, interesting. So she begins her talk, says, "During the Harlem Renaissance, Langston Hughes and Sir Neil Hurston used to engage in a debate, which Langston Hughes said that it is important for minority writers to control the representations because they could be used by the dominant majority against." And Sir Neil Hurston was very adamant that her only barometer and her only, you know, fidelity was to the art. She said, my entire career I have sided with Zora Neale Hurston in this matter until encountering the work of Aya Akhtar. So that, you know, when you're writing about Islamic identity or Muslim identity in a politicized environment like we are, and you're writing in a way that is about the audience, it's not about the Academy, which is not a knock on the Academy, I love the Academy, but I'm not writing for that audience, then, you know, you're invariably going to wade into territory where you cannot control what people are. And I don't know that at the end of the day, thought control is the purview of art. I think that's the purview of public relations. And I think that in the environment that we live in, the sort of, you know, fading late capitalist moment, the denatured environment speaks to a denatured understanding of the role of art. And that somehow we think that art is about changing people's minds about stuff. That's not what art has ever been about. So I think that, in a way, the underlying assumption behind the critique, which is fine, I mean, I have a great deal of respect for both of these scholars, but is to some extent, I think of this guy. I don't know that policing, at the worst end of it, representation, is something, you know, anyway, I'll leave it at that.
Okay. Neilesh, do you
want to
respond?
Well, no, I mean, I think that's a little also unnuanced on your part, your response to,
I was just coming right back after that.
that I would have to disagree with your characterization of, I think, both of her comments. I think Neilesh would speak for his own. But certainly, I think that for me, what is really interesting is, yes, it's an academic question, but I don't think it's academic only, because in the audience you have reactions of all sorts to it. I mean, they could be from people who are academics or not. People love, a play, don't like it, or, you know, offended by it, whatever. The question that interests me is that we have to tackle this issue of what I'm calling, and what we all, you know, hear or understand to be this burden of representation. What I was saying about your work is, what's interesting to me is that you really do challenge that. That is very clear that you are, in some ways, at least in your written work, wanting to push that envelope. And I think that that's good. That's a good thing. I don't think that that's something that needs to be, that you need to be policed or the plays need to be policed in some way. But it does open up interesting things to think about, right? They make us think critically about stuff that is coming at us from so many angles, where we're being fed all kinds of images and issues that have a history, which is, I think, where Neilesh's work is really quite interesting, tracing that, you know, the historical reference leading up to particular moments, and I think I was referring to it too. But I think where, and for me, what's interesting is that I find this grace to be, in that way, a play which pushes certain buttons and gets certain results, and I think that's interesting, but it's also problematic. I think from there, where your work is moving, at least for me as a viewer and as a reader, is much more interesting. It's opening up directions in thinking about this issue in ways where you can jettison the burden of representation without also jettisoning a sense of artistic responsibility. I believe in that.
Right, but Fawzia, the play is about what you're talking about. It's not about something that then you read, well, all the kids stumbling and falling into all of these cliches and no, it's actually about what you're talking about. So it's in active dialogue with the very discourse. This is what I find frustrating about this conversation, is that the play has already incorporated this critique. But for that not to be, for those folks who don't know the play, for them to be presented this perspective on the play is, just to me, is not, that's not true.
Mm-hmm. Now, do you want to weigh in?
Sure, I adore first response to also take that my commentary, but I would like to say a few things about this. I actually, just to follow your last comment, I think that I also, at least in my presentation, I read it that it's disgrace, which is not the only thing we're talking about.
Yes,
so much. But if that play is a central point of conversation, which it should be, I think, given the recognition and the questions that it raises, I also read it as a critique, too. But the some amount of meaning it from the point of view of representation of Muslim identities for people as Muslims. It is rather, as I said at the beginning, it's a reflection on the psychopathology of colonialism. This is something that is not really at its core about Islam or Muslims, but the particularities are about Islam and Muslims. And that's the point that I think the discussion can be both interesting vis-a-vis history, it can also be interesting vis-a-vis the aesthetic range of your, you know, what you're thinking and what you're doing. Because I think it is, exactly as you say, at the same time, it brings to light this broader critique. So I do agree, I mean, we had a little discussion before the panel about, you know, what does someone need to know about the play to be able to have an informed discussion? I mean, there's certain things that could be extracted out and that could actually give somewhat of a misreading to the play itself. But, I mean, in my last comment, it's the last thing I want to say now, is that I think what the play can do is tell us that, you know, there is, of course, all these, there are these traditions of thinking about this issue. So the Black Skin White Masks by Frantz Fanon, this, one of the parts of this book, is about colonized men and their relationships with white women. And the conclusion is that that is a pathway toward universal humanism. This is a pathway toward the universal. It has a very detailed reading of the novel, Moran's novel, A Man Who Knows. This is what's happening. Somebody who's very similar to the trajectory in disgrace. And the end point is that this is what, in a colonized situation, this is what happens to a person. This is their life course. Now, what I think is important and interesting is that in 2012, the way that this is represented seems to bear this kind of affinity. So this is then a critique of that system. This is where I ended the commentary, that this is actually how we can read all of these types of works. Not so much about the particulars of the identity politics, but about the critique of the world system. And whether or not that critique actually is activated.
Yeah, but I think where the issue of maybe some sort of a misreading on everybody's part here is occurring is that part of the point, it seems to me, that your critique raises, and which is what maybe Ayaan is sort of disagreeing with in both of our takes, is that in disgrace, that pointing to another humanistic possibility, right, for the character of Mir Kapoor, in line with what Frantz Fanon talks about, that is not signaled in the way, perhaps, that it could have been.
I hesitate to let us get so focused on one play. Let me just ask Jamil a question, and then we can open it up to the audience's questions. But a lot of this, it seems to me, this conversation is also about audience, about, as I had said, the politics of seeing. To me, it's also about the politics of context, about where the work is produced and how it circulates. So being at a theater like Silk Road, which is in a very specific community and yet gestures out sort of globally, how did these questions land for you?
You know, one of the things that has been so interesting for me, as we've watched our audience develop and grow over the years, is that people will share with us that they trust us in a certain way, and that there's a certain kind of political expectation when they walk in the door. Now, that's not to say that they aren't going to be challenged or that they're not going to somehow be made to feel uncomfortable or get angry at some point, but that there's a trust that we've built with our audience, or at least I hope that we've built with our audience, and we take that very seriously. And so it's critical space. It is not about celebratory work. I've often said we are not a self-esteem project, although self-esteem is a great thing, and we should all have some. But it really is to kind of look at these complex stories, but in a way, you know, what Neilesh just said about the sort of subtextual world, how we fill in those blank spaces and the assumptions that we're bringing to that process. So, as we continue, that is part of our dialogue with the audience. And they will oftentimes tell us that hearing, and this isn't about, you know, getting, hearing the politics of a particular piece in our space that might be, once again, very challenging and perhaps very difficult, they have that benefit of the doubt. So that, I think, is really, really important. Where that may not exist, I think more work has to be done. And I think that becomes somewhat the responsibility of the producer. I think that becomes the responsibility of the larger production team. Because there are these ideas that audiences will leave with that can oftentimes be completely counterproductive. And you know, I'm not of the opinion that we are in the business of having to make any community at any given time look good or look a certain way, but there is always this fear of fueling ideas and sentiments that are already there in the culture.
Thank you. Thank you. Are there questions from the audience for the last part of our evening? Yes, please. I'll rephrase the question to make sure that people, I mean, reiterate the question to make sure people can hear, but go ahead. Basically, if Indian Muslims have a particular role to play in, on the US stages and in popular culture. Thank you. Yes.
So if theater is a part changing people's minds,
if theater isn't for changing people's minds, what is it for?
I think at its best, the theater is about experience. It is about experience beneath the level of language, or beyond the level of language. F. Scott Fitzgerald has a wonderful quote. He says that the hallmark of a fine mind is the ability to hold two opposing thoughts at the same time and still be able to retain the ability to function. This is a Sufi technique, actually. It's also a technique you find in the Kabbalists and all the mystical traditions. There's a purpose to holding two opposing thoughts. It opens a different kind of space. It opens a space of spaciousness or an expansiveness in which the light of being or things can appear as they are. So it's that act of perception at a much deeper level, which is not about a sentence that tells me that Muslims are good or Muslims are bad or the Quran is evil or the Quran is about peace. It has nothing to do with why I'm writing plays. Anyway,
I think
you got a little bit of my animus there. I apologize. It's not meant for you.
I think that also what you're saying is not that theater doesn't have the ability to transform and change people's minds. But that's not the purpose of the artist. And
it's not your purpose.
And I think that once that becomes your purpose, then you're no longer an artist. You are then conscious.
You're a drunk.
But in doing, in presenting those opposing ideas, and that often that contradiction, which really does is this disgrace. I'll tell you, just having performed in disgrace, one of the most amazing things about the play was that as the audience would watch the play, their allegiances would change constantly as to who they thought they agreed with and disagreed with. So it was like, oh, I agree with him. She's terrible. And then 2 minutes later, wait, I don't agree with her. I think she's stop it. You know what I mean? Like, and suddenly you'd be, and so that sense of disorientation leaves you, it could possibly make you think about a lot of things and therefore lead you to other places that you haven't been before and maybe change your mind about certain things. Maybe change your mind about your certainty about things, for example. But it's not the purpose of the play to change your mind about anything. You know what I mean? So that, I think, is the distinction.
To open a different field of feeling and thinking, Ron Rosenbaum, a wonderful book about Shakespeare called Shakespeare Wars, quotes a scholar by the name of Stephen Booth, who says that what is wonderful about Shakespeare, what defines what is unique about Shakespeare is his capacity to create what he calls ideational static. There's the static, the electricity of the mind itself. But not just the mind body, the emotions, the thoughts. We feel thoughts as much as we think them.
I think that's why we all go to the theater, too. Yes, please.
Kind of going off the identity topic, does it ever get annoying, I guess, to be like a Muslim actor or a Muslim playwright rather than just like an actor or a playwright?
Does it ever get annoying to be a Muslim playwright or a Muslim actor instead of just a playwright or an actor?
Like the Holocaust, does that ever really bother you guys?
My experience, let me just say, I'm really just grateful that anybody spends any time or money on anything that I do. I really am. Can't believe that I'm gifted to do this. And if I got to carry that, lead a Muslim. Muslim can sing, Muslim can dance. Well, who knew a Muslim could write a play? That's fine. But what I will say about it is that I think that one of the things that I've recognized being in publishing and being in the theater is that if you're a woman or you're a person of color, you are assumed to be writing about identity. If you're a white male, and then, hey, like, I love white males. I mean, I guess one of my best friends are white males, right? So I got a problem with you. I'm just saying that if you're a white male, then that question does not arise. It is not, there is not the implicit assumption that you are writing about identity. So in my case, what I thought was interesting about why I wanted to read the Merkin monologue today was because the for those who know my work, the overlapping themes are obvious. And Merkin is a Jewish character, and there's anti-Semitism in the play. So I'm dealing with American identity, but it's impossible to see it when you've got to put the Muslim thing on. Well, I say I'm the same guy, right? And just writing the same stuff just happens to be in a different way.
Go ahead, Aasif, and then Jamil has that.
I think that it's kind of something that bothers me more than I think that it is, like what Ayaz said, I'm just happy that people are watching and listening, and, I think in my work, I think the one thing that does happen though, we all have our own story to tell. My story in some cases has been about my identity, and that's quest for identity, that's search for identity, because that has been one of the major themes of my life. And so I've actually wanted to write about that because it is an exploration of my own, not only as an artist, but as a human being, is an exploration of myself in the world and what it means to be a South Asian Muslim man in the West. That is the central theme of all that I have been dealing with in my life.
Jamil?
Back to an earlier question about creating change or somehow affecting change. I think it's important, and I'm really coming from a professorial place as an artistic director, that we don't have to disentangle the artistic from the activist. And that doesn't mean that every piece of art has to be somehow an activist work. However, we wake up in the morning and do the work that we do to somehow affect change and to somehow pose questions that aren't being posed or grappled with in the community. So I'm actually not interested in doing this work if I'm not somehow an advocate, if I'm not somehow an activist. Because otherwise, quite frankly, there's lots of other things I'd rather be doing. So, from where I'm, from the direction or the place that I, my own positionality, is such that we can look at a sort of healthy dialogue and a healthy relationship and a tension and a conflict at times between those two objectives.
Oh, I just wanted to comment on actually Aasif's response about his quest for identity being an overriding theme for his work and his personal life, and simply to say that I think that you have, it's the most recent thing that I can think of where it becomes clear that the trajectory has led to a point, right, where and you can really, what I call, very slyly look at burden of representation and turn it, into something that is, that doesn't feel like a burden, but in fact that you're throwing back at your interlocutors and it's just hilarious and sort of opens up all kinds of interesting questions about the viewers rather than about your own identity. And I think I'm referring to something I was just mentioning to you a while ago. If you haven't seen it, you should check it out on YouTube, but a recent roast that you did at the Congressional Correspondents' Dinner, which I thought was really, really brilliant because it took on those issues, right, that we're talking about, but just threw them right out at the audience. And I mean, that's just an interesting part to see that you're at that place where you can actually do that.
Well, it's funny, I think that often comedy itself, the old adage of like, acting comes from pain and comedy comes from rage. And I think that's what that was. I mean, the funniest stuff that we do on the Daily Show, for example, comes out of deep dissatisfaction or anger that gets
well, one of the stories in the book is called The Jihadist and Irony, and it's about how I took my, what happened when I got on the Daily Show was this idea that all of these things that I had been feeling after 9/11, all of this kind of sense of the stuff that was happening in the media and in the culture at large around those things, and was suddenly given a channel through which to say something into the zeitgeist, and it felt like my own using irony as a jihadist tool to fight against racism. But yeah, definitely, that tension also between pain and rage is another very important place to live in between.
So what's the rage that you feel at, apart from the rage of recognition? What enrages you?
Techniques. They start winning the so-called war again. When you declare victory, you take them off payroll again. And this time, you put a guy in power who starts systematically murdering each one of them. And then you start wondering, oh my God, where's ISIS come from? What happened? Where's ISIS? ISIS. Well, guys running ISIS right now are former Baptist regime guys. What's the math here? So it's the same stupidity of that analysis about the Quran and this that fuels me. It's the same stupidity of people who approach the Prophet Muhammad as a god to be worshipped. To me, it's the same enduring human incapacity to see beyond that. So that's the, you know.
I think the place to end the panel is on passion and the depth of investments that everyone on this panel has shared with us tonight. Thank you so much for your remarks. Thank you.